Hello everyone, welcome to the practice session of PMP exam questions and answers for June. Just like the previous months, in today's session, we'll be solving some medium to high difficulty level PMP exam questions very similar to your actual exam. Also, if you have not watched the previous Q&A sessions, I would highly encourage you to check them out, okay? I'm sure that you will find them immensely helpful for your PMP exam. I will link the entire playlist in the description section of this video. If you are preparing for the PMP exam, you can use today's class to assess how well you are prepared for the exam. So out of the 5 questions that we'll be solving today, the target would be to get all the 5 out of the 5 questions correct. However, the minimum expectation is that you should get at least 4 out of the 5 questions correct to consider yourself fairly well prepared for the PMP exam. Now, anything less than that, you might need a bit more preparation, okay?
Also, if you are preparing for your PMP exam in 2024, I would recommend that you register for my free webinar for the PMP exam preparation, okay? It's a detailed webinar which I host every week, where I take students like you through the basic steps of preparing for the PMP exam successfully. So I have multiple slots that are available every week. So feel free to choose from the slot that works best for you. The link will be in the description section of this video. In addition to this, you can download this free ebook, which is the 10 tips to pass the PMP exam in 2024 from my website as well. Okay. So all these resources are free resources to help you kickstart your PMP exam preparation in 2024. I'll be providing all the links in the description section of this video. So make sure you check them out.
Okay, so question number 1, guys. Please read the question and try to answer it before we solve this together, okay? You can pause the video here if you wish to. Mind that this is a multi-select question, okay? So you need to select 2 options which are correct from the 5 options that are provided, okay? And mind that you need to get both of the options correct to be awarded a full marks for this question. So these kind of multi-select questions in your PMP exam doesn't have any partial marking, okay? So please read the question and try to answer it before we take this up together. Right, so let's get started. The product director of an agile organization is worried that the team is delivering products of high perceived business value rather than high actual business value, okay? So basically what it means is the type of products which are currently getting delivered as part of this project, these have high perceived value, okay, which is, let's say, the value which is not tangible or which is something which might be perceived as highly valuable to the customer. But at the end of the day, when the rubber hits the road or when the actual product gets deployed, they will not have any actual value to provide the required benefits to the customer or to the end user, okay? So that is the difference between a perceived value and a actual value. So for example, let's take an iPhone. If an iPhone is not working, or let's say if an iPhone has a bug in it, it may look like an iPhone and someone may think that, okay, I am owning an iPhone. But in the end, if it is something which is sort of not a genuine iPhone from Apple, or is it like sort of a copy or a clone of the Apple iPhone, the person who is using the iPhone might think that they have an iPhone. So that's a perceived value, but the actual value might be very different, or the actual experience of using that iPhone, which is a clone of the original iPhone, might be very different, okay? So that is the difference between an actual value versus a perceived value. So the question is asking, which of the following approaches is recommended for the product owner, okay? And you need to select 2 of the options, okay? So the product owner needs to select a few options which will ensure that the actual value gets delivered to the customer rather than the perceived value. Right, so let's get to the options one by one. Option A, redefine the value metrics for definition of ready. Okay, now if you have been following my YouTube channel for quite some time now, I have discussed multiple times these kind of agile concepts such as definition of done, definition of ready, way of working, etc., etc. Okay, so please go back and watch the entire playlist of this monthly Q&A sessions where I have picked up these topics, and I will link some YouTube videos on the screen for you which will help you to understand agile terms and concepts which are important for your PMP exam. Now, the definition of ready is basically what? It's basically a scope definition, right? The way you define a feature to be ready should be the same the way your customer also thinks the feature is ready, okay? So your, let's say, definition of completion should not mismatch the definition of completion of your customer or of your end user, right? That is the crux of definition of ready. So if you are redefining the value metrics of your definition of ready properly, that really makes sense here, because then what you think as the actual value, or let's say what the product director of your team thinks as the actual value, is the same actual value which the customer should also think, or the customer should also align with, right? So there will be no misalignment with respect to some actual value which you are delivering versus the customer who is believing that, yes, that actual value is actually something that is tangible and it is not something that is perceived, okay? And the other way around as well, okay? So this option A seems like a good option, which is definitely recommended for the product owner. So option A should be correct, but let's hold this option for now. Let's look at option B. Re-estimate the story sizes to include more value features. Okay, now that is quite broad, guys, right? Now you can re-estimate the story sizes, okay, to include more value features. But the question still remains that whether these value features will be actual values or whether these value features will be perceived values, right? So this option doesn't give me confidence to believe that if I do this, will I be doing something different, or will I be able to solve the problem which the scenario is giving me, that, okay, will I be able to create that bridge between the gap of perceived value versus actual value in the customer's mind, or what my product director is thinking, right? So option B is definitely an incorrect option. Let's look at option C. Make sure that the product director approves every feature delivery. That is incorrect, okay? And because of a couple of reasons. Notice the word here, every, right? And I have mentioned this over my YouTube channel. I always give daily posts regarding these kind of nuances which you need to identify to differentiate between a very close wrong answer choice versus a right answer choice. So these kind of superlatives such as each, every, must, always, etc., etc., they should start ringing alarm bells as soon as you see them in an answer option, okay? Now I'm not saying that those are always incorrect, but you should judge such kind of answer choices with a litmus test or with an acid test. Now, if you look at this option C, what it is saying essentially is very, very unrealistic, okay? The product director is a very senior level position in the organization, and you can't have that person approve each and every feature delivery, right? Then what is your role as a project manager? Then what is your role as a product owner? Why are you guys getting your salary, right? So that makes your roles redundant, okay? And that is why you cannot expect the product director to approve every feature delivery. So that is first reason why this answer choice is incorrect. And secondly, just making the product director approving every feature delivery will not bridge the gap between the perceived value versus the actual value in your customer's mind, okay? So that is also something which you need to take into consideration while evaluating option C and taking the decision that why it is incorrect. Let's look at option D. Plan to develop a prioritized list of value features and integrate it to product backlog. Okay, now this seems like a plausible option, that if you build something as a prioritized list of value features, what will happen is these actual value features which you see here, these actual values will be coming as very high priorities versus the perceived value, okay? So if we go back to the iPhone, of course, a older model of iPhone, which is working and which has zero bugs, will be coming quite high in the priority list versus a, let's say, iPhone 14 or iPhone 15, which is a clone of the original iPhone, and there is no guarantee that it will deliver the actual performance of iPhone 14 or iPhone 15. Now, the customer can perceive that he or she is owning an iPhone. That is a perception, but the actual case is very different, okay? Now, when you do such kind of prioritizations of the value features, what you can do is you can align that value features with your customer, you can align that value features with your product director, so that both of them are on the same page in understanding that, yes, the most important deliveries that we'll be getting at the beginning of the project or at the initial phases of the project are the ones which will have more actual business sense or more actual business value coming out of it. And let's say some cosmetics or some aesthetics that might come later will increase my perceived value, but the overall value proposition of those cosmetics or those aesthetics when it comes in terms of delivering the actual product usability. Okay, so that is what prioritizing value features mean. And if you integrate that to the product backlog, it means that you are actually considering that as part of your next sprint or next iteration. So option D also looks as a good option to me. Let's look at option E, organize a value stream mapping training for the Agile team. Now that is quite broad, guys. Overall, a value stream map actually does something very nice. It gives you sort of a loss mapping, or let's say where your losses are in your overall supply chain or overall value chain of a product delivery. But this is some kind of a tool which is a business development tool, or let's say a product development tool, which comes at the very initial stages of product development, okay? It is a good tool, but it is redundant in terms of this scenario that we are evaluating. Again, I say this multiple times in my Udemy courses. I give multiple posts on topics like these in my membership community. So if you're interested, you can check those out as well. So the main reason why option E is incorrect is because of the reason that value stream mapping might be a good tool, but overall for this scenario, this tool will not help me to solve the problem at hand, okay? So option A is a correct answer, and option D is also a correct answer. So the correct answer to this question is option A and option D, and by that, I have selected two answer choices which the question is asking me to select for this question. And now, let's move on to question number two. Right, so question number two, guys. Please read the question and try to answer it before we solve this together. You can pause the video here if you wish to. Okay, so let's get started. The project charter is approved by the sponsor. The project manager conducts a meeting including the key team members and stakeholders. Okay, sorry about the typo here, guys. Okay, the key team members and stakeholders. The primary purpose of the meeting is to generate a project artifact that will form the basis for defining the main project deliverables. Okay, so this is the most important phrase of this question. So a project artifact which will form the base of defining the main project deliverables. Okay, and where are we? We are just at the end of approval of the project charter by the project sponsor. So we can safely assume that we are out of the initiation stage and the project has moved on to the planning stage. Okay, which project artifact is being referred to here? So scope management plan, scope statement, WBS dictionary, and milestone chart. Okay, so let's go through the options one by one. Option A, scope management plan. Now, that seems a plausible option because scope management plan actually defines the way your project deliverables will be structured, the success criteria coming out of it, what is the expectation in the way it will be delivered, which project methodology or project management methodology you will be taking to deliver your project deliverables. So let's say, will it be Agile or hybrid or waterfall, etc., etc. So scope management plan can be the correct answer choice. Okay, so let's look at option B, scope statement. Okay, that can also be correct. Now, if you do not know the difference between scope management plan and scope statement, bear with me and we'll come back to it in a second, right? Let's look at option C, WBS dictionary. This is incorrect because basically what WBS dictionary does is it gives us a detailed description of your WBS element, okay? So WBS is work breakdown structure. So in the work breakdown structure, you have identifiers, right? So for example, 2.2.1, 2.3.4, 3.4.2. So these kind of identifier or serial numbers for your work packages, okay? And what WBS dictionary gives is, it gives you the detail of a particular work package. So for example, let's say WBS number 2.3.2 is verify a design, okay? Now this verify a design will have a detail to it, right? For example, who will do it? Who will be involved in doing it? How much time will it take? How much cost will it take, etc., etc. So basically when I can say the design is actually verified, so those details of the work package, which is a WBS, is captured in a WBS dictionary, which is further down the scope development process. But if you look at this project scenario, we are at very early stages of the scope definition process. So that is why option C is incorrect. Let's look at option D, Milestone chart is also incorrect because milestone chart is basically a schedule management tool which gives you sort of a milestone list in terms of the key activities or the key developments which will be happening across the project lifecycle and when they are expected to be delivered. So milestone chart is very different from a Gantt chart because in Gantt chart you get a more detailed view of your project schedule, but milestone chart is more sort of a bird's eye view of your overall project deliverables, which is generally used in very high level reviews. So, for example, director level review, portfolio level review, etc., etc. Okay, so milestone chart is definitely out of consideration for this question. Now, if you look at option A and option B, you need to understand as a PMP exam candidate the key difference between a scope statement and a scope management plan. If you know it, you can answer the question in less than 30 seconds. If you don't know it, you will always end up getting confused between option A and option B. So, you need to remember this formula, guys. Okay, the scope statement of a project is your scope management plan plus your work breakdown structure plus your WBS dictionary. Okay, so this is the formula, or let's say the framework with which you should remember your scope statement. The project scope statement of a particular project consists of your scope management plan, which tells you the way of defining and managing your project deliverables. Then you have your WBS, which is the work breakdown structure. And then you have a WBS dictionary, which will define the elements of your work breakdown structure in a detailed manner. Okay. Now, if you look at this question, guys, you have your scope management plan, right? So basically, scope management plan is something which is developed at the very beginning of your planning stage. So we can safely assume that the scope management plan is there. But is WBS there, guys? Possibly not, right? Because WBS cannot be available before you have even defined the main project deliverables, right? It is like saying that, okay, I will define what I am going to do even before I know that what I am supposed to do, right? If that makes sense. So you need to understand what is your project deliverable before you go and develop a WBS on that. And after you have defined your WBS, you need to develop your WBS dictionary, which is even one level down your WBS, where each of your work packages are defined with respect to the details that we have already discussed. Okay, right. So in this scenario, you don't have your WBS still available because you don't even know what is your main project deliverable. You need to define that now. And of course, you do not have your WBS dictionary available as well, because that follows a WBS creation process. So once a WBS is created, then you go and create your WBS dictionary. So in this question, scope management plan is the correct answer, because scope statement of this scenario is not existing at this point in time. You have to develop your scope management plan first. You have to have your WBSs defined. You need to have your WBS dictionaries defined, and then you'll be getting your scope statement. So scope statement is a very close answer choice, guys, but it is incorrect. So the correct answer to this question is option A.
If you're liking the video, guys, please press the like button. Your support goes a long way to help this channel grow. Also, your likes and comments help me to understand that you value such educational content on YouTube and motivates me to prepare more such videos like this to help you with your PMP exam preparation. And now let's move on to question number three.
Okay, question number three, guys, the drill will remain the same. Please read the question, read the options, and try to answer it before we solve this together. You can pause the video here if you wish to. Right, so let's get started. A project team within a matrix organization is in the norming phase, okay? Team members have been deputed by individual functional managers to deliver the project. A couple of team members have had the experience of working with the product owner on similar projects previously. Okay, so a few things are happening here. So first of all, the project team is a team in the matrix organization. So what do you mean by matrix organization? It is a type of organization where a person has a project manager to report to and also has a functional manager to report to. So for example, if you are a quality assurance technician, you report to the project manager from a project standpoint, and at the same time, you report to your functional manager, which sort of have a dual reporting. So that is what is meant by a matrix organization. Okay. And this team is in the norming phase. So you know the five phases of Tuckman ladder, right? I'll pull it up on screen for you now. So the team is in the norming phase, which is sort of the first productive phase of a team formation, okay? Because from the norming phase, the team actually starts to deliver and starts to bond as a group, okay? Now the team members have been deputed by individual functional managers to deliver the project, right? So the example that I was giving, that the quality assurance technician is deployed by the quality manager of the company in the project, and the person is reporting to the project manager from a project standpoint, but from a career and from overall administration standpoint, he is reporting to the quality manager. A couple of team members have had the experience of working with the product owner on similar projects previously. So the quality technician is saying to you that, look, project manager, I have had the experience of working on similar kind of projects, and the product owner, who is the product owner of your project now, I have had experience of working with this person previously in some other project as well, okay? Because if you know now how the matrix organization behaves, that your quality technician, after completing your project, will move on to another project, and then that person will move on to another project, okay? So this is how resources are reassigned by their functional managers across various projects to help in project delivery, okay? That is how the matrix organization works. Now, the question is, what could the project manager do in this situation to maximize value delivery? So now, as a project manager, you know that you have a quality technician in your project team who knows the product owner of your project and who have had the experience of working with this product owner previously. So you have a couple of resources like this in your team. So what you can do as a project manager to maximize value delivery, okay? So the important thing to note here is you need to select an action which will maximize value delivery. Okay, so let's look at the options one by one. Option A, reassign the product owner to protect conflict of interest in line with project governance. This is really crap, guys, right? So you don't have the authority suddenly to reassign the product owner to protect conflict of interest. And of course, there is no conflict of interest here, right? A product owner who was the product owner for project X, where the project manager was Mr. Y, let's say. Now the product owner, now that product owner is now the product owner of your project, which is, let's say, project Z, right? So does it say, or does it have any conflict of interest which says that the product owner who was the product owner of project X cannot be the product owner of project Z? Okay, of course not, right? So basically, to cut the long story short, it is not a conflict of interest issue if a product owner of a different project is the product owner for your project, right? Until and unless it is explicitly called out that this is a confidential project you are working, etc., etc., which is too far of an assumption for this kind of a scenario, okay? So basically, there is no conflict of interest of a product owner being the product owner of your project if that person was a product owner of a different project previously, to cut the long story short. So that is why option A is crap. It is totally incorrect. Let's look at option B. Explore how the team members can apply learn from experience to maximize value delivery. That looks like a very, very pragmatic option to me. Okay. Basically, what it is saying here is you explore how the team members, which are these couple of members on your team, and one of them is, let's say, your QA technician, for the example, can apply their learn from experience. So their experience of working with the previous product owner, who is the product owner of your project at the moment, to maximize value delivery. Okay, so this looks like a very, very nice option. Okay, let's look at option C. Report a conflict of interest issue in line with project governance. Again, incorrect. Very, very broad, guys. On what basis you are telling that there is a conflict of interest? Neither there is a conflict of interest from the product owner standpoint, neither there is a conflict of interest from your team member standpoint, okay? So on the other side of the spectrum, we can also say that if a team member, let's say your quality technician, has worked with a product owner on a previous project, nothing is stopping him or her to come and work now in your project with the same product owner, okay? So basically, the project manager has changed, not the product owner. So that is not a conflict of interest in any sense, as far as the information has been provided in the question stem, okay? So that is why option C is also incorrect. Let's look at option D. Make the members team leaders since they already know the product owner. That is also quite random, guys, right? On what basis you will make them the team leader? Just because they know the product owner previously. Does that make any sense? Okay, of course not, right? Team leader assignment or team leader allocation or role allocation should be happening with respect to a skill matrix, okay? That person who will be the team leader should have a skill matrix which will define his or her role and that person needs to be at least acceptable or above expectation in terms of meeting those role criteria. And then you can assign that person as a team leader, and you can definitely say that your team leader is having all the right skills that are needed to fulfill that role. Do you have that for these members in your team who knows the product owner previously? Is that a skill that you are really looking for? Not, right? So that is why option D is incorrect. So the correct answer to this question is option B. I hope many of you have got this correct, guys, but I have put this question for you in this month's session to help you understand that sometime PMP exam will try to trick you in terms of believing that there is a conflict of interest or believing that there is a project governance issue when actually there is none. Okay, so please be aware of such kind of decoys or such kind of traps which the PMP exam will try to test you. I'll not say trap because that is like sort of a negative word which has a negative connotation. Let's say learnings. Okay, so these kind of learnings in which the PMP exam will try to test you. And since you are my student, you should be able to answer these questions correctly because you will already have these learnings with me as you are solving these type of questions with me over my monthly Q&A sessions, right? So the correct answer is option B.
If you are finding this practice sessions helpful, guys, make sure you subscribe to my channel PMP with Ray for more such videos for your PMP exam preparation, okay? Subscribing to this channel doesn't cost you anything, but it really helps me with extending the reach of this channel to other PMP aspirants like you. And now, let's move on to question number four.
Right, so question number four, guys. Please read the question and try to answer it before we solve this together. The drill will remain the same. You can pause the video here if you wish to. Right, so let's get started. A weather forecasting application development project includes an agile team of meteorologists who will analyze historic forecast data and trends to feed into the machine learning algorithm of the application. Okay, a lot of things are going on here. So, weather forecasting application is currently getting developed. Okay, and let's say you are the project manager or the product owner of this project. And your project includes an agile team of meteorologists who are, let's say, your subject matter experts who will analyze the historic forecast data and trends to feed into the machine learning algorithm of the application. So basically, the input of your machine learning process is the historic data of rainfall, historic data of precipitation, historic data of cloud cover, etc., etc. And what it is essentially trying to do is, it is essentially trying to feed that historic data into your machine learning model to develop the application for an output, which is, let's say, your weather forecast with X percent accuracy, where X should be ideally be 100, where you are able to predict the weather forecast with 100% accuracy. That's the ideal scenario. So your machine learning needs to learn that, how to predict the weather forecast with 100% accuracy. And the input that you are planning to give to your machine learning model is the historic, or let's say the legacy forecast data of that particular region or of that particular country. Okay, this is what it is saying. However, the sponsor wants to leverage artificial intelligence by interpreting satellite imagery and then using it as an input to the algorithm, because that is proven to be efficient and accurate than historic trend analysis. Okay. So your sponsor is saying that, look, of course, you have a set of meteorologists with you, a group of subject matter experts with you, and they are using historical trends. And that is what your sponsor is saying, that as per my understanding, artificial intelligence, which interprets the satellite imagery of all the satellite pictures and all the satellite data, which are, let's say, the geostationary satellites, which orbits around the Earth. So these kind of weather satellites, they collect satellite imagery. And it has been proven that if you have this satellite imagery, which is more real-time data, more data in terms of more volume of data that you are inputting into your machine learning model, these kind of inputs are far better than historical inputs, okay? And that is what your sponsor is saying, and that is what there is a conflict that he is suggesting that you should use as a product owner or as a project manager, these kind of satellite imagery models to feed your machine learning algorithm rather than using historical data or historical trend. Okay, so this is the, let's say, technicalities of this entire scenario that has been provided to you here. How should the product owner take the sponsor's recommendation into account? Okay, notice what the question stem is saying. Okay, it is very important. The question stem is not saying that, look, how you can make your sponsor correct or how you need to let's say, validate if your sponsor is saying something which makes sense. It is not asking you that, okay, question what your sponsor is saying or do an analysis to prove that your sponsor is correct or incorrect. No, it is not saying that, right? It is saying that point blank, accept what your sponsor is saying is correct and how you should take that into your account, okay? It is saying that how you should take your sponsor's recommendation in your account, and that is with the assumption that it is not challenged, okay? Now, it is immaterial whether you believe that your sponsor needs to be challenged and you think that, okay, historical analysis sometimes gives better results than, let's say, artificial imagery, than, let's say, satellite imagery, etc., etc. That is immaterial, okay? The question is saying that, look, boss, your sponsor has said this, okay? Take this into account and look for an option which will give you means to execute that, okay, point blank. So please be very careful in terms of not bringing your, let's say, thought process or not bringing some unwanted assumptions into the question which is not asked for, okay? It is a very, very critical learning when you are solving PMP exam questions. So with that expectation being set, let's look at the options one by one. Option A, update the risk register and plan a retrospective. Random, guys, right? Totally random. You can update the risk register with what? God knows. You can plan a retrospective with what? God knows. Because as of now, you have not even completed the sprint to come up with at least a minimum viable product. So on what basis you will plan a retrospective? That is not correct. So option A is totally out of the table because it is very random. I hope none of you have selected option A. Let's look at option B. Advise the team to issue a cost-benefit analysis comparing historical trend analysis with satellite imagery analysis. This is incorrect, and the reason is because I have already mentioned to you that your sponsor have already given you that indication that this is his recommendation and that needs to be implemented, period. Okay, you need not go back and start coaching or, let's say, start analyzing your sponsor's recommendation. That is waste of time. And that is what you are doing here. If you are doing a cost-benefit analysis and comparing historical trends, satellite imagery analysis, etc., etc., you can do that. But the question is not asking that. The question is asking that how you as the product owner should take the sponsor recommendation into account. Doing some sort of analysis which is immaterial to your project sponsor because he already believes that the satellite imagery will provide you a much better input rather than historic trend analysis. It is pointless to give a cost-benefit analysis now, okay? So option B is off the table. Let's look at option C. Work with the team to update the business case which will use satellite imagery as the input to the algorithm. This should be the correct answer because it is saying that, look, your sponsor has said this. Please go and update the business case. And now, revise the option of using historical trend with the option of now using satellite imagery for your machine learning algorithm. So option C looks like a correct option. Let's look at option D. Advise the team to issue a SWOT analysis. So SWOT analysis is basically a, let's say, a perspective analysis. So for a particular decision, you can identify the strengths, identify the weaknesses, identify the opportunities, identify the threats, etc., etc. So it's a decision analysis tool for interpreting the satellite imagery using artificial intelligence. This is incorrect, guys. Again, pointless, right? Again, I go back to the phrase of this question stem, which is saying that how you as the product owner should take the sponsor recommendation into account. It is not asking you that, okay, how you can challenge your sponsor, how you can validate that your sponsor's claim is correct, etc., etc. It is not asking that, guys, okay? So be very specific of what the question is asking from you, okay? So that is why doing these kind of analysis, theoretically, it makes sense. It might be a lot of intellectualization for you and your project team, but in the end, for this question, this is immaterial and redundant. So option D is incorrect. The correct answer is option C, which is to work with your project team now to update the business case, which will use satellite imagery. It will not use historical data or historical trend anymore as an input to the algorithm. Okay, so the correct answer to this question is option C.
I hope you are finding this exercise helpful, right? Remember, the target is to get all the 5 out of the 5 questions correct. However, the minimum expectation is that you will get at least 4 out of the 5 questions correct, okay? So here comes the 5th and the final question.
Okay, so question number 5, guys, please read the question and try to answer it before we solve this together. The drill will remain the same. You can pause the video here if you wish to. This should be an easy one, and I hope many of you should get it correct, okay? So please pause the video and try to solve the question. Okay, so let's get started. During the execution stage of a project, a couple of changes were proposed which the customer thought were necessary for the project. The project manager, The project manager sensed an underlying discontent within the team members with regards to how these changes will be implemented within the project. Now, let's analyze the scenario first. So, the project is in the execution stage, first thing. So, the project has moved from initiation to planning and now it is in the execution stage, first thing to note. Secondly, a couple of changes were proposed which the customer thought, okay? It is a thought process which the customer has given, okay? It may not be correct, may be correct, we don't know. It is not backed by any analysis. That is what can be safely assumed, okay? So, the customer thinks, okay, now he may think anything under the sun, but that doesn't necessarily mean the project manager should go and start implementing whatever the things and the wishes of the customer is. That is very important as a role of a project manager, that the project manager should think rationally and also rationalize the customer if he or she or they, the customer, is thinking very differently in terms of how the project should be managed, etc., etc. Now, the project manager sensed an underlying discontent within the team members with regards to how these changes will be implemented within the project. Okay, now the team members are saying that, look, boss, we are okay to implement it, but one of the team members is saying that, okay, we should do it by option A. The another team member is saying that we should do it with option B. Another team member is saying that, okay, we should do it in terms of a different option, which is option C, let's say. Okay, for example. So there is a bit of a conflict in terms of the way this will be implemented. There is no conflict in terms of the reasoning of why it should be implemented or why not. We can assume that, okay, it can be implemented, but there are different ways of doing it. What should the project manager do? That is the question stem. So let's look at the options one by one. Plan a meeting with the sponsor and the project board to seek their advice. I hope none of you have selected this. This is incorrect, primarily because this is an escalation. And if you are planning a meeting with the sponsor and the project board for these kind of scenarios without actually yourself getting involved in terms of at least identifying some recommended solutions, what is your role for, okay, or what, why you are getting your salary, okay? Let's say, for example, that if you're doing such kind of stuff, your role is redundant. They may replace you with some another project manager, okay, who can do their job, taking much more ownership, okay? So please do not select any option in your PMP exam which generally talks about escalations, which generally talks about, let's say, calling meeting with your sponsor, project board, etc., etc. Again, a word of caution, guys. It is not one size fits all. 99% of the scenarios, these kind of options are incorrect, but there are 1% of the scenarios where escalation is necessary. Okay. I have discussed such kind of nuances in my 35 PDU course, or I have given multiple posts over my YouTube community on such kind of nuances in terms of identifying the right answer versus the wrong answer. Okay. So let's move on. Option B. Plan a meeting with the team members to perform best value option analysis for the proposed changes. Okay, you can do that. I was talking about option one, option two, option three, etc., right? Let's hold this option for now and see if that is the best thing to do. Option C, review the change management plan and confirm if all stakeholders are adhering to it. Okay, I think I have discussed this concept of review before act, right? So review before you act, okay? So this is very important. You should not take any action without reviewing the relevant documents first. This is one of the key principles of project management. This is one of the key principles with which the PMP exam also phrases its correct and incorrect answer choices. So option C is saying here that, okay, you can do, you can implement these changes, but please review the change management plan first, okay? You see that whether what the customer is proposing that is in line with the change management plan. Let's say the customer is not proposing something that is unreasonable or something that is not captured as part of your change management plan, and make sure that all the stakeholders, which includes your customer is one of the major stakeholders, are adhering to it. Okay, so option C looks like a much better choice than option B, because option B is saying that please go ahead and start implementing, start doing analysis of your changes which the customer has proposed, etc., etc. Basically, it's skipping the review part and directly moving into action. So generally, these kind of options are incorrect. Let's look at option D. Prioritize the changes on the basis of cost impact and plan to implement in order of increasing impact. Okay, so it is saying that, okay, you prioritize the changes on basis of cost. So for example, change one will take $500,000, change two will take $700,000, change three will take, let's say $900,000, for example. Now, in order to implement that, I do change one first, then I do change two, then I do change three, because change one is the least cost, or because the change one has least cost of implementation. You can do it, you can or may not do it, but again, it is not something which PMP exam, or let's say the way PMI drafts PMP exam questions, recommend. And again, what about schedule, right? Okay, you have taken into account cost, but what about schedule? Let's say the least cost impact change might have a very long time of implementation, right? Then what you do? Again, do you change that project schedule for that? You don't know, right? So there are a lot of ifs and buts. So that is why option D is also incorrect, okay? So the correct answer to this question is option C, which is to review the change management plan first, because it falls within the framework of review before act, and confirm if all the stakeholders are adhering to it, because it is a thought for the customer. Maybe the customer has not done a due diligence in terms of proposing these changes. And when you hold a mirror in front of the customer, they may say that, okay, yes, I understand it was unreasonable change. Please roll it back. We don't want to do it. Please proceed with the original baseline plan. Okay. So that is how, as a good project manager, you have rationalized the customer and prevented them from taking any unnecessary or any detrimental decisions which will impact the project badly. Okay. So option C is the correct answer. Option B is incorrect, because it is directly jumping into the action part without reviewing the relevant project documents or the project artifacts first. So B is a very close answer choice, guys, but incorrect. So the correct answer to this question is option C.
So that's the end of the quiz, guys. Let me know in the comment section below how much you were able to score. I'd be very interested to know that. Also, if you have scored less, do not get demotivated, okay? You just need a bit more practice and a thorough analysis of your mistakes so that you get to know about your knowledge gaps. Now, to help you practice more and eventually get better, I'm linking here the entire playlist of our monthly practice sessions for the PMP exam questions and answers. Please check if you have missed any of the monthly sessions and make sure you practice with me in those sessions as well. I'll see you there.